Hi, and welcome to another Java by Example. Today we are going to continue our series with the multi-layer Perceptron, and a method that I read a blog post about this topic that Leftris had written. Can't really pronounce his name. I think it's Leftris Karapetas or something. And in this tutorial, he very simply went through and discussed how you set up and make a multi-layer perceptron and how you write that in C and the different things that are involved in that. So I thought to take this example he had and break it down and do a Java example of it instead. And by breaking it down, perhaps explain a little bit more how multilayer perceptron works. The sad part is that I think this series will end here because I have tried this one and the results was not that good. So I will come to that later, but let's start with looking at the few changes I had to make in order to make the example I implemented earlier to work, because I had done some bugs, not that many, and some of them was just choices that I made that made it look a bit nicer, and maybe they didn't have that much of an impact. First off, I'll start off with saying that this is a git diff output, and when you look at a git diff, all the red lines are the removed or the old lines, and all the green lines are the new lines. So if you haven't seen it before, this is pretty much what you have to look at. So firstly, I imported random because later on I wanted to use the random class instead to generate my random numbers so I could seed them. I'm not sure that that is important, that you get a better random seed, but I thought, why not? I could try that out. And then the next row you have here, then I had switched the nodes and the layers. So I actually created, I think, 3 nodes with 24 layers. And I thought that was a bit strange, so I changed those up. And then here is a very bad one. I didn't set any value for the input nodes, which meant that I had 0 input nodes, so I never actually sent any data into the network. And 64 is the number of nodes required because we have an image with 8 pixels squared, 8 pixels by 8 pixels big, so that's 64 pixels all in all. And if we continue down in diff here, you see the random change. We have created the random object and set a seed to the current time in milliseconds, and then we create floats from that between minus 0.5 and 0.5. So that's not a big change. And then we have this row here where we, if we look over here, I have actually, you are transferring from one row to another row, and I actually had minus 1 in both cases, so I never transferred any values. So I just added the same row over and over again, which made that the network actually didn't have any changes in the data. So that was a sad mistake that I had to fix. And also, when we are working with 3 different arrays, is a good way to not copy the pointer. So I actually made a full copy of the array to the new previous weights. And lastly, we have I have removed the breakpoint at 1000 epochs, and I let it go for all the epochs it can do. And because we have set a value for the least mean squared error. And we actually hit that value quite fast. I think it was after like 3,000 epochs or 2,000 epochs or something. So I thought that maybe I'll try that out first. And yeah, I type out the error for each 1,000 so I can see how the changes progress. And then I had some changes to the recall network where I actually sent in the answer and return a 1 or a 0 depending on if the answer was correct. So I could calculate and see how many correct answers I got for this network. And then I changed the output somewhat so it was easier to read, and I could just see each row one at a time because I wanted to run this many times. So let's remove this one and open up the code editor so I can look at the specific changes I made here. And if we look here, I take a key set, the key set, and make that into a separate string array or string list and sort that. And that's because when you are managing a map or a string or a list or any collection in Java and you actually iterate over those, you can't really remove things from them because then you will have an error that you remove something that you are iterating over, because when you iterate over them, they should be immutable. And why do I do this? Because when you are actually testing your network the correct way, you should remove the test data before you train the network. So you have a training set that you use for training, and then you have a different data set that you actually test on in order to prove that this network that you have created can actually find the example of the test data it has never seen before. So I had to make this collection separate that out. And then we go through this collection and we pick out the answer, we remove the key, we train the network with the standard values that I saw in the example for this executable that he had in his blog post. And then I recall the network. And if the network finds the answer to be correct, I return a 1 and increment my correct value. Otherwise, it's not incremented, so that will be the same. And then I put the key and the answer back into my map again. So for each iteration of the key, I remove the one that I want to test and then put that back again so I can test each of the answers separately and get a good feel for if I have found something that works. And when I did this with the network I had, it actually ran through and gave me 8 of 22 correct. And that's not that good number, because if I had 11 of 22, then it's just a guess. It's a 50-50 guess. So I should at least get 11. I should get a lot more, but at least 11. So what's going on here? And I tried to run this application that he wrote to test his things. And it actually trains the network first. So it has trained a network with the full data, everything that it has seen before. And then you are prompted to enter an image to test. So then we have already made a network that is perfect. So it shouldn't have any defects at all, because it should know every example. And when I tried it with each and every one of them, I actually got the result that it got it right 18 of 22. That's very weird, because it should have gotten every one of them correct. So I implemented a function down here where I first trained the network and then went through and recalled all the values, and I actually got the number 22 of 22. So my network was perfect at recalling what it already knew, which his program wasn't. So that's a bit strange. As I said, I had actually trained the network with about 3,000 epochs. I thought that that might be a strange a thing that I shouldn't do because it could be too good. So I changed this down. So I tried with 2,000, I tried with 1,000, I tried with 500 epochs. And with 500 epochs, I got zero results right. With 1,000, I got a few, and 2,000 a few as well, but I never got above 11, which is what I should have gotten at least. So either I have implemented something very wrong in my code here, and if you can find that, please hit me up, leave me a comment explaining what I have done wrong. But my thought is that we actually have implemented this correctly from the example, but our problem is that we have too few test cases. We have 22 test cases, and that is actually too few cases to train in order to get a good sample. So I think because we have such a limited network, such a limited test sample, I think that we are hard pressed to actually get any viable results from this method. I hope you learned something about the theories behind multi-layer perceptrons, and that you found this topic interesting, and perhaps you want to try to implement this in a different language. And I would really want to try this out with a larger test set. So I will look into finding some more data and actually running this on a lot more data and see if I can get any better results. So please, if you like this video, give it a like, share it with your friends, and leave a nice comment with what you thought about it, and if you have implemented a multi-layer perceptron yourself, what your results was, and if you have any other comments, pretty much. And if you want to see this code, it's available on GitHub. My GitHub profile is Kalaspuffer, and this is a project called MLP, so it should be quite easy to find there. And yeah, I hope you like this, and I hope to see you in the next video.